Council.
Hello, my name is Todd Tuthill. I'm the Vice President for Aerospace and Defense globally at Siemens Digital Industry Software. My job is to represent the customer inside our industry to bring the understand the needs of the customer, bring those needs in, and then use those to set strategy for where our products can go so we can better meet our customers' needs. You know, software is used in so many ways. We talk about sustainability. Software is used in the development. Software is used in manufacturing. And if you look at, I represent digital industry software, but there are other aspects of digital industries as well in terms of factory automation, in terms of motion control. And we use software to do all of those things. We help our customers all the way through, you know, from the beginning, from the initial ideas to the fielding and manufacturing. And software allows you to optimize all of those processes and all of those products, even to the point of support and the lifecycle support of it. And it starts with large amounts of data, aggregating and connecting large amounts of data. But our software goes beyond that, allowing our customers to do real significant things with that data through digital twins, through generative design, as well as optimization of generative designs. It does that and so much more. There's a whole section of a hall here dedicated to advanced air mobility, and that's such a critical new thing, flying cars in the aerospace industry. It's very exciting to me. There's several companies are demonstrating those in various places. We're seeing real models, and we're going to see those certified and in use soon. And I'm very excited to see that here and the growth of that here, and I look for a larger growth and maybe a whole entire hall. Maybe in 2 years here in Paris, we'll be dedicated to nothing but those particular industries. So that's very exciting to me. Most of the products we see in urban air mobility, they have a lot of assistive technologies, the way to make those complex aircraft fly easier. But there is a company, Wisk, who's taken it one step further. Wisk has taken the pilot out of the cockpit and created a remote drone, which is an incredibly interesting play, I think. It's much harder for certification. It's much more risky. But Wisk is a customer of ours, and I was speaking with Wisk recently about that. And they really believe, and I think we do too, that that's an interesting play because it really removes the need to have a pilot in every aircraft. If you think about the skill set needed to train pilots, to put pilots in those aircraft, that will be a limiting factor for how far urban air mobility will go. But if we can get technologies like the ones Wisk is promoting relative to pilotless flight, that really opens the door for the proliferation of this technology. So it's a risky play, but a very interesting one that I certainly hope that the industry adopts and works with. And I think eventually you're going to see more and more competitors going the way of Wisk if Wisk can get it right. But a lot of great technology, a lot of things there with respect to software-controlled flight. Of course, the customer's looking at a way, it's a combination of several requirements. It's a new market that doesn't exist. So customers are looking at ways to develop new technologies, incorporate new technologies in a sustainable way, but also in a profitable way. We're looking at areas of the topic is energy density of batteries and how can we improve the range of these aircraft. And there's ways to do it. You can put more energy in the aircraft. You can make the aircraft lighter and able to do more with less energy. But I think that's a big topic and really a question of in terms of how will those things be profitable. And it's really key to lighter aircraft, better technology, better batteries. And then, of course, the question of is the electric technology that an interim step or is that the final step? And I think that's a question we're all asking, with respect to that market. But also if you step up to the regional air market, which is really looking at hydrogen, there's some interesting things here about hydrogen as well. And companies doing that, where does electric become hydrogen? Where does that make sense? And again, is hydrogen an intermediate step? Or is hydrogen a final step? And I think right now in the industry, we don't know. Certainly, we have nothing in terms of green technology to look at dual-aisle aircraft that will fly across oceans other than SAF. So again, lots of interesting things going on in sustainability in that market, lots of new technologies being developed, but I really see this as very, very much the beginning. You know, I think back to 2007 when we all used phones with keyboards, right? And we talked and we all first saw an iPhone. Yeah, you know, I kind of see us as this is maybe the iPhone moment in the aerospace industry. We're just beginning. We see promises, but there's a lot more to come. A lot more to come in urban air mobility and in sustainability. Yeah, digital twins are really at the heart of what we talk about. Again, we talk about the ways to help our customers go faster, help our customers do things with fewer resources. And if you think about the development of aerospace technology, they're very, very complex things and very expensive to build. The last thing we want our customers to do is to build something physically only to find out that that wasn't the right design or that it doesn't do what we need it to do. And what digital twins allow our customers to do is to try things out, learn things, make the product better, optimize the product digitally, virtually, before they build it physically. And that's really the heart of what a digital twin is. And we have what we call the comprehensive digital twin at Siemens. It's not just the digital twin of the product, which is what we traditionally think. We certainly have that. But we also have the digital twin of your production, because our solutions span the whole gap of early design to physical practical design to manufacturing up to support. And we have digital twins all the way along that to help our customers understand. And our digital twins don't just end once you've built your product or built your production. But we actually use technology to feed back information from the real production to understand how to optimize production after production starts. And you take the data from production, you look for problems, and you feed that back into your digital twin of production to optimize it, to do trades, to find your ways to get better. We want to help our customers to constantly improve. If you think about the life of an aerospace program, we may take 3 or 4 years to design it, but we may spend 30 to 40 years, our customers may spend actually doing the manufacturing. And new technologies, new techniques are constantly being developed. And our digital twin technology gives our customers the ability to optimize that through the whole life cycle of their manufacturing over 3 or 4 decades. So all kinds of ways to use digital twins before, during, and after production and fielding of a product. Digital twins are central to our strategy and central to the way we help our customers improve their products. We're talking to lots of customers. And again, in terms of needs, one of the key needs that customers talk to me about in almost every conversation is the matter of workforce. And one of the other areas that I think software is really helping is the ability to allow customers to multiply the impacts of the engineers and the staffing that they have. Because it's clear to me with the large amount of investment, you know, I tell people all the time, there's so much money in aerospace, that's not the limiting factor. The limiting factor on the innovation and all these great things we see, limiting factor is not money. It's not the interest and desire to accomplish something. The limiting factor in the next 5 to 10 years in aerospace will be workforce. And to me, the key to overcoming that is we're training more people. We will not train and build enough engineers in the aerospace industry in the next 10 years to do the things we need to do. It's not possible. Digital transformation, I see and we see at Siemens, is the key way to help our customers bridge that gap, to multiply the impact of their current workforce, to help them do more. It's just such a critical thing that will really help our industry accomplish more, attain the goals of sustainability, attain the goals of defending countries, of doing all the great things we need in aerospace. But it's a digital transformation. It's not just optimizing the products they have now, but it's helping build a better workforce, creating a better environment for that workforce to work, to allow aerospace to accomplish more. Digital transformation offers so much, and we've just scratched the surface, you know, just scratched the surface on digital transformation, where we are and where we can go.